It's common for games to share engines. Sometimes it's games in the same series, other times they're completely different franchises. The 3D Zelda titles in particular have used evolved versions of Ocarina of Time's original engine, with OOT and MM being nearly identical at this level. Starting with what I affectionately refer to as the Six Zeldas, an engine overhaul was needed to make the switch from N64 to more advanced consoles. They still retain some aspects from the N64 titles, like the ability to manipulate the game's memory. However, the similarity in terms of performance and potential is most similar between the Six games. Hundreds of thousands of Zelda fans were first exposed to memory manipulation at AGDQ 2020, where Skyward Sword and The Wind Waker were featured fresh with Song of the Heroes skip and Barrier skip, breakthroughs that severely changed their speedrun routes and commonly used techniques. Skyward Sword's masterful application of manipulating memory through gameplay is something quite unique and is hard to come by something similar in another game. In contrast, The Wind Waker's method of memory manipulation through actor duping also carries over to another sick game, Twilight Princess. Yes, I did. So I packed it up and brought it back to the crib. Just a little something to show you how we live. Everybody want it, but it ain't that serious. That's that shit. So if you gon' do it just like this. Did you realize that you were attacking in their eyes? In the GameCube Zeldas, each time Link dupes or duplicates an item, more data in the game's memory becomes inefficiently stored. This process is called fragmentation and can be used to unload just about anything. In The Wind Waker, you can unload the barrier with this method you can learn more about in this video I made last year. In TP, actors can be unloaded by duping the fishing rod. Anywhere there's grabbable surfaces or you have access to a Epona, the animation for taking out the fishing rod can be interrupted. Just like in The Wind Waker, repeatedly doing this will fragment memory. You might be wondering though, if this trick exists in both The Wind Waker and Twilight Princess, why hasn't there been a TP world record in over a year? Why is it still a glitch hunter's prison? Unfortunately, actor unloading in Twilight Princess is much more limited. This is due to one major difference in the update between TP and The Wind Waker's code.
Every time you use the grapple hook, the game commits a predetermined amount of memory to DYN space. After the item has been pulled, the memory is supposed to come back because of a memory leak exclusive to Wind Waker. When items are invisible, that doesn't happen, so the memory is never restored.
This oversight allows you to keep memory fragmented across loading zones into completely different areas. Since this memory leak doesn't exist in TP, you're limited in methods for duping, and this method has to be achievable in an area with the actor you want to unload.
Well, Twilight Princess has a barrier. Why not take Epona to the barrier and dupe the fishing rod until it unloads?
Now that would be a fantastic idea that could possibly save hours in the speedrun. Unfortunately, you can't do it. Zuko, pride is not the opposite of shame, but its source. Twilight Princess has two barriers that prevent you from getting into Hyrule Castle early. Jim's Elusive Glitches video explains how skipping this proto-barrier is currently impossible, but everything I say next will for the most part apply to both barriers. The real barrier is physically much smaller than the Wind Waker's barrier, but it likely takes up about the same amount of space and memory. A ridiculous amount of fragmentation would need to occur in order to unload it. Attempting this in one area could easily force a hard crash or even unload the door tied to the loading zone. This is why the memory leak is important in the Wind Waker. It allows you to create fragmentation in a stable manner while maintaining progress throughout loading zones. Since this isn't possible in TP, we'd have to go all in and hope it doesn't crash. This would require getting Epona into Hyrule Castle Town or another map where the barrier is loaded. Epona is quite temperamental, and while she could stand on pretty much any collision or even fly out of bounds, taking her into loading zones she wasn't meant to go through, like Hyrule Castle Town, almost always crashes the game. This is due to an interesting idiosyncrasy with how maps attempt to load actors in the game. In every map state, there's a list of actors that are meant to be loaded in the area. When opponent's actor is called onto a map where she isn't on the list, the load can't be completed and the game crashes. The addition or absence of actors, however, normally doesn't cause the game to crash. This was found out in 2007 by MZX Rules. He somehow managed to load Lake Hylia, but without the water. Unbeknownst to him, this glitch, just like actor duping, could end up being a potential solution for barrier skip, and all we'd have to do is pay this little guy a visit. Keep Puppies are integral to this game. You might not be able to pet them, but Nintendo graciously had them follow Link around and let us cuddle with them. Presumably to test out the hardcore puppy mechanics, a special version of Hyrule Castle Town exists, with no people, 20 dogs, and most importantly, no barrier. When on this map, neither the barrier nor the guards load. However, there's also no polygonal collision loading zones. Thankfully, the loading zone for Hyrule Castle is tied to the action of opening this door. Entering Hyrule Castle this way would cut out at least the entire second half of the run, yielding an any percent speedrun easily under 90 minutes.
Wait, we're getting ahead of ourselves here. This is a developer-only map. How do we get here, and what does this have to do with emptying Lake Hylia?
Areas generally have a set amount of states. A state is a version of the map that's only active under specific conditions. One of those conditions could be having a certain item, completing a quest, or progressing through the story in some way. The default state for most maps is 0, with alternative states usually having the value of 3, 7, 8, or 9. During a loading instance, if no conditions are met to override the map state, the next state, while accounting for story progress, should be the default. In the case of Wagon Escort, a flag is set whenever Link voids out or dies. The area then loads the previous state instead of the default state. After a game over occurs, an override takes place that puts Link back in the same location with a flag that triggers a small cutscene where we can see Link getting up. However, we could force the game to do this in other situations. When Link dies in the Plum minigame, it sends you back to Lake Hylia, and the cutscene from before plays again. This triggers the glitch, and Lake Hylia is put into the state it was during the minigame, rather than its default state, state 10. Lake Hylia is not defined in this state, so none of its state-dependent actors are loaded, including the water. To load the puppy room, we would have to die while entering Hyrule Castle in a situation where Castle Town is supposed to be set to state 0, and the death has to be from a location in state 8 or 3. The Hot Springs minigame in Kakariko tasks Link to deliver a barrel of water from Malamart to the Goron outside the east entrance to Castletown. The minigame conveniently sets up Hyrule Field to beat State 8. We would just have to play the game up to this point, making sure to pick up bombs in the Clawshaw along the way to be able to complete Hyrule Castle and load the puppy room. However, setting the cutscene flag while respawning in Castletown is currently impossible. Another dead end. Okay. Perhaps attempting to save hours in this game is a bit too ambitious. Maybe we need to think a bit smaller, like 3 to 5 minutes? Invalid death warps don't seem like a valid candidate, but perhaps we could use actor unloading to optimize some sequence breaks we already have. Twilight Princess historically has some rather large sequence breaks right at the beginning of the run. Our initial goal is to get the boomerang and use it to escape the forest as fast as possible. To do this, we go through the following steps. Bonking into this fence skips Ordon's day 1 and 2. An LGA skips Ordon Revisit, and a super jump allows us to get the Master Sword early, which lets us get into the Forest Temple much earlier than intended. Well, what if we could skip doing all of that? Could we get the boomerang right away, with the trade-off being requiring the fishing rod? By continuously duping fishing rods until available memory is low, the loading transition in South Faron will fail, and we can ride Epona out of bounds and leave her here. By doing this, we could pick her up in North Faron and enter the Forest Temple early. Then it's just a matter of getting the boomerang and using Uku to leave. Great, so we're able to escape the forest in half the time. Too bad there's one big problem with this. Since we can't do back in time and get the fishing rod, we're stuck with the Ordon clothes and the wooden sword, which is like beating enemies with a stick in your jams. This also prevents us from transforming at will. The dichotomy between human and wolf Link is very important to the run, and getting the Master Sword allows us to switch between the two at will. Without the Master Sword, if we escape the forest and head to Eldin, Link would be transformed into wolf forcefully, with no way to leave Eldin or progress. Escaping the forest and heading to Linera presents a similar problem. This time, there's no force transformation, and as human Link will be stuck in Lake Hylia. We can enter the Sacred Grove in order to obtain the Master Sword with the same method used to get to the Forest Temple. Instead of bringing her around the loading zone, we can instead ride her to the Sacred Grove. However, now our roadblock is this wall that requires Wolf Link to Hallalat in order to open. Technically, we could get through this wall with the rupee slide if you have 10 hours to spare. Even if we had a fast method to get through this wall, obtaining the Master Sword without the hero's clothes crashes the game.
So that's it, right?
Twilight Princess is over. It's dead. It's a prison.
As of right now, it seems so. Large discoveries that end up being useful for any percent haven't been uncovered since 2015. That doesn't mean we should stop looking though. Plenty of smaller time saves have been found throughout the years. Not to mention, Twilight Princess had many of its major sequence breaks and large glitches found before 2009. At this time, it was on a similar level to Ocarina of Time in terms of brokenness, a comparison that's laughable today. It seems that, in the wake of other 3D Zeldas having a renaissance, this game is just much sturdier than the others. If you want to help us break out of this prison, join the Twilight Princess Speedrunning Discord. Any help is appreciated. Hey, you see this video on the screen? Check it out, it's pretty cool. I swear, I wouldn't lie to you, it's pretty cool. You can also go to my Twitch or my Twitter for some occasional streams and some really dumb tweets. Any clips that I've used from other people are going to be in the description along with any of my sources for the information that I got. Like this video if you want to see more, and make sure to tell me in the comments if you want to see any other topics in the future.